I'm Dr. Lucius Pomerantz. In this video, we're going to be talking about Parry Fractures, also known as nightstick fractures. In this video, we will be focusing in on a particular type of fracture. It is a fracture that has happened to many mixed martial arts fighters, just to name a few. Tony Ferguson, Frank Shamrock, Randy Couture, Paige Van Zandt, Rich Franklin, and more recently, Jared Cannonier. This fracture, also known as a broken bone, is an isolated fracture of the ulna. This is the part of the forearm that is placed in front of a person when they are warding off an attack. This type of fracture has also been called a nightstick fracture, and is often seen when an individual defends against the nightstick or wooden police club. This was the term that I learned in my training, but another term for this injury is the parry fracture. A parry is to deflect or block an attack. Those of you who punch and kick people for sport know exactly what it means to parry a strike. And unfortunately, many people in mixed martial arts have sustained this injury. Most recently, Jared Cannonier versus Robert Whittaker. Let's start with the anatomy. Our hands are a huge part of how we interact with the world, and how we get our hands in the right position is extremely important. The ulna is one of two bones in the forearm. The forearm connects the elbow to the hand and wrist, but it does a lot more than just make a connection down the arm. The bones of the forearm can rotate around each other to allow for the hand to face up or down. We call this supination or pronation. Supination is like holding a bowl of soup. Anyways, to describe how these bones move around each other, imagine the ulna in a fixed position and the radius rotating around it. At the elbow, the ulna is the larger of the bones and makes the hinge joint of the elbow, while the radius rotates in a circle. The ulna tapers down to being the smaller bone at the wrist, and the larger radius will rotate around it while we supinate or pronate the hand. There are multiple ligaments. You can see my separate video on ligaments that connect the two forearm bones that help maintain their important relationship to each other and to distribute forces as they travel from the hand and wrist on to the elbow. In case you're curious, the forces that go through the hand and wrist up to the elbow are distributed in general with 20% of the wrist forces going through the ulna. However, at the elbow, 40 to 45% of the forces go through the ulna. This means that forces going through the radius at the wrist are transferred over to the ulna as they travel toward the elbow. If the ulna is broken, then forces from the hand and wrist go through the fracture, which hurts. If a bone of the forearm is significantly deformed, then the relationship between the bone and the other forearm bone is altered. This may prevent proper rotation of the forearm or even cause the wrist or elbow joint to not work correctly. The most common cause of the parry fracture in mixed martial arts, and in general, seems to be from attempting to block a strike. In mixed martial arts, it's often a kick where tremendous amounts of force are generated. This can be seen in many circumstances. Ferguson versus Johnson, Cannonier versus Whittaker, the list goes on. But there have been a few instances of it occurring during an offensive strike, such as the spinning back fist by Paige Van Zandt that lands on the ulna. Despite the pain and loss of function in the arm, many of the fighters that were previously mentioned were able to get to the end of the fight. Some actually won the fight. Randy Couture versus Gabriel Gonzaga and Rich Franklin versus Chuck Liddell are examples. Nonetheless, broken bones hurt, especially when you have to keep using the arm. When watching these fights after the injury, it clearly limits the function of that arm. As an orthopedic surgeon who treats these injuries, many of them do not need surgery. Many can heal with immobilization and time. However, some do require surgery. If the fracture is significantly maligned or if quicker recovery, more predictable outcome is absolutely necessary, such as in a professional athlete, then surgery may be the best option. For more information on bones, see my video on that topic. The most common way for orthopedic surgeons to fix these fractures is to place a plate and secure it with screws to hold the bone in place while the body can then take over and heal. It often will take 6 to 8 weeks to heal, even in the most ideal situations. Once the bone is healed, there can be a difficult choice to make about keeping the plate and screws in place or to remove them. The plate is a stress riser. By that I mean the bone will see extra force where the plate ends because the plate is stronger than the bone. However, to take the plate out requires another surgery and time for the screw holes to heal in before the bone reaches its maximal strength. Based on what Paige Van Zandt has put out there on social media, she unfortunately has had to deal with multiple injuries based on these issues. Our goal as orthopedic surgeons is to get people to their best function and limit risks. The decision of treatment often weighs the patient's preferences, their activity level, goals, and other health factors. In the end, we want you to be able to keep moving. I'm Dr. Lucius Pomerantz. Thank you for your time.